I needed to learn more about the pancake nipples, so I traveled to this weekend's GP, where I tested the new Sarkhan deck 26 times. And now we've got the data from those 26 matches, so we can figure out just how good this deck is. But if you haven't seen the first video on this deck, all you need to know, Goryo, Emrakul game 1, and then game 2, Ensnaring Bridge, Chandra to finish off. And by switching the game plan, it throws off a lot of opponents. But now let's talk about the data. I'm going to split it into two parts. One where we include humans in the matchups, and one where we don't include humans in the matchups. Because it turns out this deck does not do very well against humans. Let me give you the numbers on the non-human matchups first. So if we ignore the human matchups, the win percentage with this deck is 71.43%. That's very, very high. So that's the good news. The bad news is that I played humans 5 times. I didn't even know I could play the same deck 5 times out of 26 matches. It's kind of ridiculous. But in the 5 times I played humans, I lost every single time. And it wasn't like I was misplaying against humans. It's just humans are really good against our deck in both the reanimate version and the prison version of the deck. So when you include those 5 losses to humans, the win percentage drops to only 57.69%, which is still pretty high. But if it weren't for humans, like, the deck could do so much more. And it hurts extra knowing that I queefed humans into the world and now they've turned against daddy. But in case anyone's confused, let's talk about why humans is so good against our deck. First of all, meddling mage. They can name a card, we can't play it. If they name Goryo's Vengeance, we can't play Goryo. And winning game 1 is almost impossible unless we ultimate Sarkhan. And even in game 2, if they know we're on the prison strategy, they can name Ensnaring Bridge, Chandra, and we're also in a tight spot there. On top of that, they have Kitesail Freebooter. They can take a non-creature card from our hand. In one of the matches I played at the GP, someone Kitesail Freebooter me 4 times in one game. It was horrible, but it doesn't stop there. Reflector Mage. Emrakul says it has protection from all colored spells. If they vial in Reflector Mage in response to Emrakul, Emrakul gets bounced to hand. On top of that, they run Thalia, which makes non-creature spells cost 1 more to cast. The deck was just like built to destroy us. It's terrible. And on top of that, humans is the most played deck in modern right now. And it's like the Sarkhan reanimate deck, it just wants to take off. It just wants to fly. But humans though, humans, why have you betrayed me? But it's not over yet, because we're making some changes here. The big change being 2 Torpor Orbs in the sideboard. Anyone that was around for the Splinter Twin combo in Modern probably knows what Torpor Orb does, but in case you don't, Torpor Orb is an artifact that costs 2, and it says creatures entering the battlefield don't cause abilities to trigger. So why is that good against humans? Because most things in the deck are triggered abilities, like Kitesail Freebooter, it's a triggered ability. Champion of the Parish, if a human comes into play, it gets a 1-1 counter, but not with Torpor Orb. Reflector Mage, same thing. Thalia's Lieutenant, same thing. And the new card, Militia Bugler, Torpor Orb also stops that. And as an added bonus, Torpor Orb stops anti-artifact creatures like Reclamation Sage, so when it enters, an artifact is not destroyed, which means if we're going Torpor Orb and Ensnaring Bridge against humans, they likely won't have a way to deal with either of them once both are out. Another matchup that Torpor Orb really helps against is elves, because even though Ensnaring Bridge is really good against elves, they have Shaman of the Pack, which causes us to lose life equals number of elves they control, and Torpor Orb stops this as well, and that's pretty gangster. So we're going to see this deck in action, see how well Torpor Orb helps us, but before we do, I do want to talk about the matchups at the GP, because there's so much to talk about in those 26 matches, but if you really want to see the new gameplay, you can skip to this time on the screen here, but otherwise, let's talk about a few of these matchups. First of all, against Tron, you'd think we'd have a tough matchup because we can't really switch to the prison strategy with it because you have things like Oblivion Stone, Ugin, Karn, and stop things like Chandra and Ensnaring Bridge. But it turns out our Tron matchup is really good if we stick with the Goryo strategy both game 1 and game 2. I played Green Tron twice at the GP, and both of those matches were 2-0. Like, both game 1s were Goryo into Emrakul, and then game 2 in both matches, it was Ultimate Sarkhan, while using Collective Brutality and Thoughtseize to slow down the opponent. So I was pretty surprised there. I also played Affinity 3 times, and all 3 of those matches went fine. Game 1, it was tough because they are pretty fast, but game 2 with Ensnaring Bridge, the games felt pretty easy, even with cards like Signal Pest and Ornithopter there, which can get under Bridge, but we can keep those cards at bay with Grim Lavamancer, Collective Brutality, Lightning Axe, so all 3 of those matches against Affinity were fine. Another surprising matchup was Blue-White Control. I played it twice, both those matches were wins, because with cards like Thoughtseize and Collective Brutality, we can clean out their hand pretty hard and then play things like Chandra, and once Chandra's out, it's pretty much game over. Another one was Burn, played it once, won that match, had Leyline of Sanctity game 2, and then kept the Goryeo plan in all 3 games. One matchup that was really tough though was Mardu Pyromancer. With all the discard game 1, things were pretty tough. In game 2, because they had Lingering Souls, I just couldn't get the bridge lock on them, and they were able to pull off the win on that match. And then there were a couple of matches where it was super close, but enough talk, you're probably ready to see the gameplay. So here it is, and don't forget to subscribe. Opening hand is not that great. Not a whole lot of card drawing stuff, so we're gonna mull. This is not much better, but we'll keep it. Ooh, bottom that. And might as well Thoughtseize to pass the time. Well, how lovely. There's a 0 chance of us winning here. So here's the insta-concede, because I don't want them knowing what we're going into game 2 as. Because the only change I'm going to make, I'm put in 3 ley lines and dump Malfegor and 2 voices. And with that, let's go to game 2. That was a fast game 1, wasn't it? Oh, dang. No ley line. This is too good to not keep, right? Dang. All right, we'll keep it. 2 Goryos, though. Even if they discard one of them, we still have a second one. So try and make this work. What a thought. Takes a Collective Brutality. Interesting. And we pull Sarkhan. We should probably play Sarkhan using Simian. Up it, but no discard. And pass back. There's no way they have double discard here. Kiln Fiend. Oh, man. Do we go for it now? Yeah, let's just do it. It seems like a waste because they're only sacrificing three things, but we do have Sarkhan to back it up. I think we'll be okay. And then they concede. Fastest match ever, right? So going into game two, we're going with the backup plan. Hopefully they don't recognize the deck. So we'll swap out the usual, put in the usual. And with that, let's go to game three. Opening hand's not terrible, but I really want to try again for the ley line. So we'll mull. Yeah, yes, indeed. Land on top ley line and take that. Opponent Faithless Looting's back to us. Blood the Bloodstained Mire, pass back and a Kiln Fiend. That's okay. What are the odds they have Blood Moon though? We'll get a basic just to be safe. I don't think they would, but you never know. Leyline, okay. So let's go Collective Brutality. Hitting our opponent, killing that, discarding this. Ooh, a Leyline of the Void in hand. Doesn't matter though, we have no Goryo. All right, looks like we bought some time and back to our opponent. If they did recognize the deck though, they would have brought in Dreadbore probably to destroy Planeswalker. Well, even after seeing Sarkhan last game, they might. All right, cool, pull land. Let's go Ensnaring Bridge and pass back. Opponent plays Leyline of the Void. They got us. What can we do? Another bridge. Do we need that though? I don't know, maybe. Yeah, we'll take it. Never have too many bridges. Back to our opponent. Opponent Thoughtseize himself takes the Inquisition. I don't really know why. What are they digging for? Yeah, I don't know. Keep in hand for discarding stuff, I guess. Opponent digs some more. Bedlam Reveler. More digging. I mean, they didn't see the ley line last game. Maybe they saw it in the graveyard. The red and black can't really deal with ley line very well. I don't know. Chandra, where are you? You're not Chandra. Bottom. And pass back. Ooh, Culligan's Command. But we still have an extra Ensnaring Bridge. But how many Culligan's Commands can they pull? I guess we shall find out. Land, didn't want to see that. So back to our opponent. Monastery. It can actually hit us, but oh well. We got a 13 day Faithless Link. They must have a second one. Otherwise, they would have just conceded probably. All right, fetch. And we pull Squee. So play Squee. Do we want to discard that? Yeah, I guess we're going to have to just top deck stuff. All right. Uh oh. For a second, I thought that was Colgan's Command. I was like, oh no, three. They only have 23 cards left in deck. Manamorphose. Manamorphose again. This is some intense digging. We have 41 cards left in deck. They've drawn 20 more cards than us. I feel embarrassed. We're supposed to be the digging deck. Another bridge. All right. Bridge number three. So at this point, let's find out how many Colgans they have. If they still play this out, that means they probably have two more in deck. Simian, cast. Back on opponent's turn, Kiln Fiend. Back on our turn, Temple of Malice. Chandra? Do you want to just completely demoralize them? Yeah, we'll keep that on top. Never have too many bridges. Take that, morale. How can you deal with three bridges? You do not have three Colgan's commands left. It's impossible. All right. Only a matter of time before we get Chandra. And do we want to fetch our last basic? Probably. Okay. There you go. There's Chandra. Up, oh, Chandra. Ooh, another Chandra on top. No. They could have Dreadbore, though. Leyline? Okay. Opponent plays another Bedlam Reveler. We pull Thoughtseize. Let's Thoughtseize him. See if there's like a Dreadbore there. Ah, what a place to end on. So he must have had nothing, man, I guess. Right? I mean, yeah. All right. Well, it wasn't that fun. So luckily, it seems he didn't see the video and he didn't see the Ensnaring Bridges coming game three. And it's nice to know we can instant concede game one and still pull off the win. So then on to the next one. Opening hand, not super great, but Sarkhan, yeah, we'll try it. Start things off. Temple of Malice. Don't need a second one of those. Bottom that. Pass back to our opponent. Neonate. Okay. Ooh, and a bridge deck. Nice. You gotta be careful though. They can be pretty fast. So best move here, I think. Tormenting Voice. Discarding Bloodghast. Okay. Let's see what our opponent's got here. Cathartic Reunion. Blengevine. Bloodghast. Opponent passes back to us. Oh boy. Faithless Looting. Sarkhan. Collective Brutality. If they get Vengevine back, actually the smartest thing would probably be to kill the Bloodghast. So let's try Faithless Looting. Oh, muy grande. It's a little too early for it, but couldn't hurt. So dump both Emrakuls and then get one back with Goryo. And there's a concede. We had the Collective Brutality in hand to finish. So pretty good. Pretty good. Gotta say, I'm kind of disappointed in Vengevine so far. I was expecting some fast stuff. That wasn't fast. We faster. So going into game two, we're gonna dump the Emrakuls, the Goryos, the Malfegor, Bloodghast, Tormenting Voice, put in four Ensnaring Bridges, four Chandras, and three Ley Lines. They may or may not have discarding stuff. Usually though, Vengevine, Sideboard, they tend to bring in a couple Thoughtseize and stuff like that, mostly for graveyard hate stuff, but we gotta expect it. So with that, let's go to game two. Ooh, we can turn two Ensnaring Bridge. They might have discard though. How can we pass up turn two Ensnaring Bridge though? Keep Leyline in the Void. Oh, they sure got us. Too bad they only have four cards in hand. Ooh, but they hit Vengevine though. Not bad, not bad. Another bridge. Let's go Thoughtseize. Well, that's an easy pick. Can't pick those. And back to our opponent. Opponent hits us for one. Passes back. Faithless Looting. Bridge or Looting? I think we have some time. Let's go Looting. Lightning Axe. Dump a Squee. Brutality. We don't really need it. Probably should have boarded out. And just pass back. Opponent plays Neonate. So you can dump a bridge now. And opponent swings for one. Sure. And a Ballista. What? Why didn't they play the Ballista sooner? All right. Fetch and pull land. Well. Let's go bridge. I like how they're a bridge deck and we're like also a bridge deck, you know? It's like the battle of the bridges. I'm supposed to go to combat. Watch this. This is, oh man, I'm enjoying myself too much. All right. Exile this. Cast Lightning Axe. Get, take out a zombie, dump a mountain, so we're down to one card, so only one thing can attack. It's like my favorite thing, like they think we're tapped out, and like, oh good, we can attack, right? Nah. Nah. Opponent swings for one, and back to us. Land, cool. So we'll play the land. Chandra? Another bridge. they could pull like a Blissa. There's actually two Blissas in graveyard. Ballista can kill us. I don't think anything else they have would kill us, though. I think the third bridge, overkill. It probably is, isn't it? I don't know, though. We'll keep on top. I just love them bridges so much, you know? All right, back to our opponent. I mean, they could have been expecting artifact graveyard hate. So just in case they start pulling a bunch of stuff. I mean, it's not going to happen, but like, whatever. Whatever. Let me believe. Let me believe that the bridge on top was the right move. Boom. Nothing from them. Back to us. Tormenting Voice. Luckily, it's not too bad. The worst thing is, though, when they have like something with one power and this gets stuck in hand, you have bridge out and they can get under it and they can pump it. That's too much. Which is why Tormenting Voice, it's like the weakest link of the deck, I feel like. Where game one, it's all right. And then game two, it's like, game two with the bridge is like, yikes. Okay. Tormenting Voice, cast. Shoot, that's going to be stuck in hand for a while. Well, we could actually lose this one, even though it's not that likely. Opponent goes Faithless Looting. That's a lot of bridges. Another Faithless Looting. Opponent swings for one again. We go to 12. Back in our turn. Collective Brutality, good. Should look at their hands. Should we kill this thing? Maybe we should kill that thing just in case. Yeah, I doubt they have anything in hand with instant of sorcery. They usually don't in that deck. So the supplier dies. Their graveyard stuff goes in. But nothing good. But so far, we're safe. Steer. Ooh, that could be good against us. If they're searching for something. Oh, look at all these zombies. Gravecrawler. Ooh. So if they have an answer, they could just Gravecrawler. This here, Steer. Gravecrawler. Dang, and that's what they're doing. Shoot. Should have saved that Collective Brutality. Gotta sit here and wait. They just have a few creatures. Ooh, and there's Chandra. I kind of want to kill the Seer. But like, if they had something, why don't they just keep scrying? Because they have tons of things to scry with here. Unless it's already on top. I think the best move here is just to go for the kill. Up, Chandra. Faithless Looting. Nope. They go to 11. Back to them. Some more sacks. And stuff going on. Dang. 22 zombies. I mean, only 22 zombies. Gravecrawler. The thing is, even if they have an answer to bridge, they can only draw one card per turn. So it'll take at least three turns to get rid of all the bridges. Maybe they're looking for Ballista. Huh. That could do some damage to us. Like, literally. And figuratively. Simian. Nice. Exile top card. It's almost tempting just to kill it with Chandra, but then they can get in two there. Now, they can only bump it up once per turn. I think we can try and find an answer. Up with Foothills, then just cast Simian, hard cast, and back to them. Opponent fires Faithless Looting. Opponent puts an extra counter on Ballista and passes back to us. Sarkhan, cool. So we shall up Chandra. Nope. Play Sarkhan and then back to them. I mean, they pretty much have to ping the Chandra because I highly doubt they'll let us ultimate it. Oh, I love seeing all these zombies come out. It makes the bridges seem so good. Not their bridges though, our bridges though. The thing is, they don't have any more Ballistas. They have three Ballistas in graveyard. So it's not like they can just bring another one in and do extra pinging. So they're going to be stuck on one extra ping per turn, which could keep Chandra at bay, but eventually Chandra's gonna get him. It kind of reminds me of The Walking Dead, where like they're all inside and there's zombies outside, you know? And like the zombies can't get in, and opponent does ping. Cool. And let's see here. Let's play that tap. Oh, probably should have done Chandra first. I always forget to do that. Ooh, bottom. Okay, up Chandra. Faithless Looting, nope. Up Sarkhan, and then pass back. More zombies. I'm pretty sure they scry through the whole deck. They have 25 cards left in deck. All right, back on their turn. 47 zombies. Flyer. More scrying. I think the only way we can lose here is if the game just breaks. Like maybe there's like a zombie cap to the game or just like restarts after like 100 or so. Oh, and there's a concede. Bummer. But they for sure didn't have any answers. Let's see. What would we have drawn? Yeah, we would have gotten them. And with Chandra out, the best they could have done was one damage per turn, but Chandra's going up by one each turn. There's no out. I think they're just trying to get as many zombies out as possible just to say that they tried, because you don't see this every day. There's like 51 here. 51 zombies is pretty good. Interesting, interesting. But on to the next one. Opening hand. This seems all right. Second land would be better, but we'll keep. Start with Temple of Malice. Look at the top card. Land. Nope. Emrakul. Bottom that. And back to our opponent. If we can hit a second land next turn, Simian into Sarkhan, that's really good. Sleight of hand, ooh, probably Storm. No second land, but it is Goryo, so can't really complain there. And just pass back. We could Lightning Axe if they play Electromancer or Brawl. No. Shoot. Darn, no land. But let's go ahead. Thoughtseize. Brawl, Gifts Ungiven, Grape Shot. We'll take Gifts Ungiven. And back to our opponent. Come on, play Brawl. We need a target for Lightning Axe. Ah, no, come on. We do hit a land, so we could... Man, maybe we should have kept that Thoughtseize now, because then they could have, well, could they have fired? I guess they couldn't really have fired the gifts. Man, we're so close, so close. I guess we'll just go Sarkhan. We might be able to get away with it. Nope, Reman, sure. Back to our opponent. That Reman was not there before. Sleight of hand, gets the land. Ooh, is this going to be it? No. But we're missing a third land to do Goryo. Oh, that's so painful. So we got a tough call here. We got Baral there. We could do Collective Brutality, take a non-creature, or we could Lightning Axe the Baral. Collective Brutality is probably the smarter move. Let's go ahead. ahead and do that. Two modes, the Noxus Revival, gifts and given back to hand. Or no, back on top of the deck. Ooh, shit, I forgot about that. Darn. We can take Grape Shot, but we're now in a bit of a bind. Do we take a Ritual instead? Ugh. No matter what, they get Past in Flames and Graveyard. I guess just take a Ritual. Dang, they might get us here. I think they do get us. I don't think we can get out of this. Gifts and given. Graveyard, Past in Flames, Ritual. But yeah, shoot. I think no matter what we did, I mean, should have Lightning Axe the Baral instead. I didn't really think about them having Noxus Revival. Yeah, that's game. Shit. So close. We had the combo in hand. Oh, well. On to game two. So going on to game two, I'm going to dump a Lightning Axe, Bloodghast, Tormenting Voice, and Malfegor to put in three Ley Lines and one Grim Lavamancer. And with that, let's go to game two. Opening hand. This is pretty good. We'll keep one Ley Line. Do we want to go with the second one? I think one's enough. That way we have some stuff to discard. Squee. Nope. Autumn. Baxter opponent. Seeming Visions and a Lavamancer. Well, that doesn't do much now. Play it and pass back. Another Seeming Visions and a third one. Never have enough of that. Okay, we get Squee again. You know, I swear there's a glitch on Magic Online where if you bottom a card, I feel like it makes it more likely that the same card comes back on top. I swear. It's happened so many times, but I talked to people at MCGO and they said, oh no, it's just your imagination, but I don't think so. Lightning Axe, we could do Emrakul now. I wouldn't be surprised if they had Remand or something in hand. So, interesting. So, opponent Bolster Grim Lavamancer. We could have almost done the Emrakul, but we didn't have enough mana there. So, we'll just pass back. Op, and opponent passes back. Faithless Looting, cool. We'll go Looting, get Marsh Flats, and pass back. Sleight of Hand. And opponent passes back. It would be nice to grab like a Thoughtseize or something. Make sure the coast is clear. Another Emrakul. Seems kind of dumb, but I think the best move here, play the Squee. Pausing here, nah. Keep this untapped to psych them out, and then pass back. Brawl. We're safe as long as they don't bounce this. Let's let them do their own thing. Could axe the Brawl. I don't think that's the right move, though. No, we gotta be patient here. Op, Metamorphose. If they have Empty the Warrens, it doesn't really matter. Ritual, and Empty the Warrens, sure. And opponent passes back. Sarkhan, well, definitely should go for it. The other thing is, we have two Goryo, so no matter what, we're gonna get the win here. Lightning Axe, Brawl, discarding Emrakul, and then Goryo. Actually, no, we're one mana short. Shit, I forgot. I miscalculated that. All right, let's go for it. See if they have a Remand. Nope, so it was worth the risk. I thought we had an extra mana for a second. I was like, oh, we could just double Goryo. It's like, why didn't I see that before? And then I'm like, oh, shit. So there's game two. It's kind of frustrating there because they could have had the Remand. But oh well. Going to game three. I think no changes. Grim Lavamancer, I don't really know. Probably don't need it. Yeah, let's go back to the axe. I think that's a little bit safer and easier to get the Emrakul combo off. And with that, let's go to game three. Opening hand is very good. We shall keep. Opponent passes back. Sarkhan. Next turn, we can Sarkhan if we want. Two untapped. Kind of afraid to do Sarkhan now. So instead, let's go Collective Brutality. Look for instant or sorcery. Interesting. Doesn't deal with Leyline, nor does it deal with Emrakul, but it does get in our way. We'll take the Unsubstantiate, though, because they could bounce the Sarkhan. Pull Squee. Well, let's go for Sarkhan. Discard Squee. Another Goryo. Cool. Factor opponent. Brawl. Let's see. What do they got? Nothing. There's Lightning Axe. Sarkhan. Discarding Squee. Simian. I think it'd be safe we just go for Lightning Axe on Brawl, just to buy some time. Could also ultimate that. Do they have Remand or anything? Nope. All right, back to them. Blood's land. Passes back. Squee to hand. There's Emrakul. A little bit risky if we do it now, though. Let's go for it, because worst case scenario, they find a way to stop it, but Sarkhan's still on six. So Emrakul hits graveyard. We'll try and bring it back. See if they have anything. They Remand, sure. And back to them. Up, and then passes back. Nice, nice. Thoughtseize. So we shall Thoughtseize. Maybe Metamorphose. Yeah. Then we shall go discard. We Lightning Axe. All right, that's fine. Back to our opponent. So last turn, they only had Mana Maker stuff. The draw here. Oh, dang. That's pretty good. We could go Sarkhan again. We can try and, let's go Faithless Looting. All right, let's see if they have anything. We'll test it. So Emrakul hits the graveyard. We'll use Simian to exile. Two mana open. We shall go Goryo Emrakul. Yeah, they couldn't respond to that. They gotten too lucky too many times this game. I mean, lucky with Wipe Away. I mean, they're pretty unlucky besides Wipe Away, but it was lucky that they pulled Wipe Away right before Sarkhan was about to ultimate. But someone with no lands and five life, I would not say is all that lucky. All right, let's try and finish this off. Sarkhan, discard Squee, and then pass back. Sleight of hand. The odds of our opponent winning this one, though, maybe like 20%. Maybe 20%. But isn't that hard to double Emrakul or even triple Emrakul? Because we have a lot of card drawing going on here. So we should go Temple of Malice, another Sarkhan, bottom that, up Sarkhan, nope. And why not just play Squee? Put our opponent on the clock and then back to that. They pass back. Squee back in hand. We'll up this to discard Squee. Leyline, sure. We shall swing for one, which is 20% of their life. Squee is such a big boy. And then Wooded Foothills, pass back. Three lands. That's pretty good. Pretty good comeback. Tormenting Voice. Yeah, let's go Tormenting Voice. Discarding Squee. Temple of Malice. Yeah, play that. Yeah, we could use that. So up Sarkhan, discard Leyline. Go Faithless Looting. Ah, no Emrakul. We do have Collective Brutality, though. That's really good. Discard Sarkhan, land, swing for one, and then Collective Brutality, discarding, Sarkhan. Oh, dang, five rituals. That's quite nice. I mean, nice for us, right? Because next turn we win with Squee. See if we can get the top deck here. They pass back. Just to make it more brutal, let's go Thoughtseize. And there's the game. So we finished off with Squee. We could also ultimate this. But yeah, surviving one Emrakul is pretty tough. And then surviving a second thing, whether it be Emrakul or Collective Brutality or even Squee or this ultimate, is pretty tough. And there are a couple times with GP where I doubled Emrakul like back-to-back turns. Oh, so nice. Like in that moment, the opponent's just like, wait, I'm at 5 life, but I can still win this. I can still win. And then like the very next turn, Emrakul again. And they're just like, my hopes are dashed. Anyway, opening hand is not great. We do have Sarkhan and Squee in the same hand, but four lands, Tormenting Voice. We'll go for it though. We can turn one, turn two, discard, turn three. See how fast they are. Oh, is this humans? Please be humans. We're gonna get crushed if it is humans probably, but I wish I had a better hand to start with though if it's humans though, because humans will ball fondle us pretty hard. Okay, keep this on top. Back to our opponent. Another vial, and they passed back. So kind of a slow start from them. So let's go Tormenting Voice, dumping Squee. Okay, we just need Goryo. And it is humans. So let's see what they get. Pretty much everything they play hurts us. Thalia hurts us. And then they pass back. Well, could cast Squee though. Yeah, I can block Thalia. And just pray for Goryo. Thalia's a tenant. Opponent vials and Mantis Rider. So that's 8 damage coming in. Or maybe more. Yep, there's more. Okay, so we shall chump here. And then we go to 14. You're not Goryo. So you can deal 9 to us already. Dang. All right, let's go Sarkhan. Discarding Squee. Back to our opponent. It's just we had Anger of the Gods right now. Just look at that. Just be a board wipe. Mantis Rider. And that happens to be exactly 13 damage. Wah, wah. All right, so it's game 2. So we bring in everything here. And then dump all this. And with that, let's go to game 2. On no Torpor Orb. Fine. At least we have a bridge. At bottom. Play Temple of Malice. Lightning Axe. Tempting. But we'll bottom it because that's not Torpor Orb. But I'm play a Seachrome Coast. And we pull Squee. Well, we'll just pass back. Which is these? Arc Champion. Sure. Of all things that could have been, Arc Champion's probably the best one. For us, that is. At least it's not Thalia. At least it's not Meddling Mage. At least it's not Kitesail Freebooter. Ooh, Lavamancer. But for the time being, let's go Sarkhan. Dumping Squee. And then pass back. This can be a Mantis Rider. Indeed, it is a Mantis Rider. So there goes Sarkhan. He's in a better place. In hell. Squee, keeping graveyard. Ooh, muy grande. So we shall go Torpor Orb, Lavamancer, and Blood Crypt tap. Pass back. Opponent plays Phantasmal Image. I guess copying Auric, right? No, Mantis Rider. Oh, that's right. They haven't seen the bridge yet. When I was a kid, I used to play against myself in Magic a lot. So maybe that's why I have a hard time understanding that he can't see our hand. Because I was so used to being able to see both hands. Anyway, all right, back on our turn. Ooh, Chandra. But we'll go bridge and pass back. Opponent swings in for one. Can't block it. We get a land here. That would be most gangster. Another champion and Kite Sail. But Kite Sail doesn't trigger. We could kill the Kite Sail. Yeah, I think just to be safe right now, we need to buy some time. Keep Squee in graveyard. Oh, it's a land, but not the one I was hoping for. If we hit another land that could untap this turn, that could be Chandra, second ability, Sarkhan. But now 2 damage can get through. We kind of have to go Chandra. Another Torpor Orb. Might as well keep Torpor Orb on top because he will exile right now. Because the only way they can kill this is with a creature usually. They don't really bring in non-creature removal for artifacts. So I think we're good. Probably should have played the Temple of Malice after Chandra last turn. Yeah. Oh, well, probably won't affect the outcome though. One of us, one that Chandra, sure. Phantasmal Image, another Arc, sure, why not? And, oh, a fourth one. Goody. Land, okay. Let's go up Chandra. 2 to them was the land. And then Sarkhan. Land, up Sarkhan. So no attacks from them. They could have the red human though that deals damage. Oh, wait, no, it wouldn't deal damage to us because of the triggered ability. I don't think they can get out of this one. It's so cool seeing that Thalia's lieutenants come in and not do anything. How nice. Another bridge. Let's up Chandra. Land, play the bridge. Sarkhan. And pass back. Back on our turn. Another Chandra. So we'll discard that. Another bridge. Cool. Let me pull a Collective Brutality. Well, I think 2 bridges is enough. Let's do Collective Brutality 2 modes. Actually, we can't kill the champion, so let's just do 1 mode and drain. Okay, then play Ensnaring Bridge because 3 is better than 2. Back to our opponent. And they concede. Feels nice. Feels nice to finally get a game off of humans for once after losing 5 matches at the GP to humans. All right, I say no changes. It's tempting to bring in Malfegor to make them sacrifice stuff, but does not work well with Torpor. So let's keep it as is. Opening hand, not too bad, but no Torpor Orb. We'll keep it though. Turn 1 Lavamancer's not bad either. Ooh. Turn 1 Sarkhan's not bad either. So let's go that. Simian, and Sarkhan. Discarding. Kind of would be nice to put something in graveyard for Grim Lavamancer, so dump that. Another fetch. All right. Back to our opponent. We're going to see a Kite Sail Freebooter. That's fine. Our hand's pretty ass. Takes Faithless Looting, and then hits Sarkhan. Sure. Oh, like my mama always said to me, eat my ass. I don't know why I fetched for a swamp though. Should have been a mountain, but whatever. Then up Sarkhan? Yeah, sure. And then pass back. Dang, should have been a mountain. But I was just so excited though. And reminiscing about my mama's words of wisdom. Opponent hit Sarkhan for 2. And then Arc, sure. Ooh, and a High Arc? Sure. Ooh, nice bridge. Okay. Okay, let's discard land, yes. Play the bridge. Now, a lot of these guys can get under the bridge. We're probably going to lose Sarkhan in the process, but the goal would be to dump our hand, get Grim Lavamancer out, hit the nobles, and then we'd be good. But Sarkhan, we're probably going to lose it, though. Like, by next turn. Nope, this turn. I forgot to get attack with that still. It's fine. We're doing okay. Back in our turn. Grim Lavamancer, land, and back to them. Opponent swings in. We got to take it this time. With disease. Plays the bugler, but triggered ability doesn't happen. Sarkhan, nice. Play Sarkhan. Up it, and then pass back, and we'll Lavamancer whatever Noble Hierarch tries to attack. Or whichever. Did I say whatever? Should be whichever. We use proper English here on the Magic Age YouTube channel. Opponent swings in with a Noble Hierarch. We shall hit it. Oh, and they concede. Oh, this is the first time we got humans with this deck. Oh, nice. Oh, after losing so many matches, I'm just like, it's impossible. But then all you need is insane pulls. You just need to pull Torpor Orb and Ensnaring Bridge back to back. It's all you need. But that was insanely lucky, though. I mean, just having Torpor Orb in the sideboard, like two of them, does not guarantee a win against humans because they could just get all their stuff off before. And we're lucky we didn't see any Thalias or even meddling mages naming Torpor Orb. Oh, but it's nice to know we're not destined to lose against humans. I is happy now. Well, that went pretty well. We happened to win all of our matches, but that's not to say this deck is unbeatable because we know it is quite beatable because its win percentage of the GP was 57% if you include humans, 71% if you don't include humans. So there are losses there. In these four matches, though, we just happened to win. We got lucky a lot of times, like with a human deck. I was pretty sure we'd lose it because even having Torpor Orb, it's not a guaranteed win. So we got lucky there. And even against Black Red, we were pretty lucky because they had a lot of discarding stuff and we kind of just got lucky game two and three, even though we had an instant concede game one. But I was actually kind of hoping for a match loss this time around because last time we only saw one match loss to Eldrazi Tron, but that's just how it is. And I want to try and get this video out soon because I know I'm really late on uploading. But at the GP, when the deck did lose, it was usually over some stupid shit. Like one dude, like, oh my gosh, it was blue red thing in the ice, right? So game one against this deck, Goryo into Emrakul win, right? Game two, I stick with the Goryo plan. They get thing in the ice out, they win. But game three, I thought it'd be clever, bring in Ensnaring Bridge, right? And what do they have? An Abrade. Why would blue red control bring an Abrade in against a Goryo's deck? Like the dude had to have seen the video. There's just no way. Like in game three, they didn't see any artifacts game one or two. Like, well, this doesn't make any sense. So they got game three and it was just like, ah. And there were so many of those matches at the GP that were just like one draw away from winning. Like, one, oh my gosh, this one time, Sarkhan was out. I just fired his ultimate. There's four dragons out. Chandra was also out. And I was at six life, right? But the dragons don't have haste. So I passed back to the opponent and they top deck a lightning bolt and they had a lightning bolt sitting in hand. And I was just at six life. And it was just like double bolt for the win. It's like, no. And that was game three. It was game three. And it was a hollow one deck too. So like, it's like anything else they could have drawn would have. It's like stuff like that. That's how the deck loses. Just like stuff like that where it's like, it's almost there and something just slips through the cracks. But as far as how good the deck is, it seems really good. But I think a lot of that has to do with the meta right now. There isn't a whole lot of discarding stuff. Like Jund's pretty far out of the meta. And Jund used to be the deck that caused all this discarding and made combo decks really hard to pull off. But with Jund gone, it's like, well, there's humans. And humans is kind of like the new Jund, but not really. But in a way, it's like more kind of mid-rangey, hand disruption, stuff like that. But other than that, it's like this deck just seems to have a lot of good matchups. But how long that'll be, I don't know. The metagame's changing so fast. It seems like every week is just a new metagame, at least online. In paper, though, word of caution, if you want to build this deck in paper, it is a little iffy with sideboarding because the way you have to sideboard, like for this deck, you can't just sideboard in one card at a time because then it'd be obvious that you're bringing in a ton of cards. So the way you do it, you just throw your whole sideboard in the deck, shuffle it, and pull out the cards you don't want. And that way you're pulling out 15 cards from the deck every time. But it gets kind of exhausting, especially to the GP where you're doing like 26 matches. So that's somewhere between 26 and 52 times that you have to shuffle your whole sideboard in and pull out the cards. And sometimes you're like, wait, I'm missing a card. And you got to go back through the whole deck again. But on Magic Online, it's a lot easier where you can just dump the cards in sideboard. So it was quite enjoyable on Magic Online. In paper, though, that's my word of caution. And if you do plan on building this in paper for your LGS store, just be aware of the metagame there, because if there's a lot of human decks there, even with Torpor Orb, it's gonna have rough matchups against humans, and sometimes it's really miserable. So if there are a ton of human decks there, I probably wouldn't build this deck. Or maybe if there are, just you can play the deck if you want to make your friends feel good about themselves that play humans. But I guess that's it. I mean, there's so many stories in the GP, like I want to tell all of them. Like another time, like one time Bridges out, I had Simian Spirit Guide in hand, right? And they had a bunch of little 1/1s, and they saw the one card in hand when I passed back to their turn. And they were like, oh, I get to attack, right? So they're like super happy. Like, oh, move to combat, right? And I exile Simian Spirit Guide to make one mana. And they're like, wait, now you have geo cards in hand? I'm like, yeah. I don't know. You had to be there, but it was just great. Oh, and like the moments where like the opponent would be like, I would try and do the Emrakul and Goryo thing and be like, and they're like, that doesn't work. You can't do that. It says shuffle. And it's like, you can call a judge if you want. And they'd call a judge and the judge would say the exact same thing I told them. And they'd be like, I don't see how that works. But then the judge would just be like, yeah, it works. Oh, the satisfaction. But I guess that's it. Maybe we'll come back to this deck at some point, but I think it's pretty perfected. Actually, no, I think that we could. If people start recognizing the bridge, we could put something in like Pack Rat, Rabblemaster, even like Young Pyromancer. We could even splash white for Lingering Souls. You know, so if they expect the bridge, we have something else. But maybe, I don't know. We'll leave it at that for now. And if you want to see more content like this, be sure to subscribe. But that is all for now. And as always, I hope you have a great day.